Hello everyone, welcome to the head lunch seminar. Today our only speaker is Professor Dimitrios Sakis. And Dimitrios is actually a professor in astronomy and physics at University of Arizona. He grew up in Greece and he got his bachelor's degree from Aristotle University in 1992. Then after that he moved to US for graduate studies and he got his PhD degree in 1997 from University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign. And after that he did postdocs at CFA and MIT before he joined the faculty member at the University of Arizona in 2003. And he's currently a member of science team of Event Horizon Telescope and NASA's NICER mission and the ESA's LOFT mission. And today he's going to talk to us about the strong gravitational field in your construct.
Thank you. Is this working now?
So thank you very much for inviting me to speak in this forum, and it is really bringing a lot of wonderful memories. You just heard my, you know, that I was here about almost exactly 20 years ago. And what was interesting back in 97 is I got interested in gravitational lensing around black holes and neutron stars. And Ferial and I actually worked on two, that's where we met, and we worked on two theoretical projects, one what happens next to a black hole and one what happens next to a neutron star. And it turns out that both of them, 20 years later, became critical ingredients of two major experiments that we're now involved in. And unlikely, both experiments are happening within a month this year, so we haven't been getting much sleep. One is the Event Horizon Telescope, which I'm going to talk about in an ITC talk sometime in early May. But the second one is NICER, is the whole idea of measuring the properties of neutron stars using gravitational effects and how gravitational effects determine those measurements. And this is the kind of project that I'd like to focus on today. Now, is this working? Yeah. A lot of what I'm going to talk about is work by Michi Baubock, who was our graduate student in Arizona. He just graduated this year and moved to the Max Planck Institute in Bonn, and C.K. Chan, who is a postdoc in the group, working on a lot of gravitational lensing aspects. And of course with Ferial, and some of the work applied to not really NICER, but the Bursar work that I'm going to talk about is in collaboration with Dipto Chakrabarty at MIT, and of course the entire team at NICER that you know, has made all this possible and realistic. What is the fundamental issue? Neutron stars are in many ways as relativistic as black holes, because if you were to plot the masses in radii, and as you all know, we don't really know exactly what the radii are for given masses because of equation of state uncertainties, but they're all very close to this line here, to the left of which is inside the horizon of a black hole. So pretty much every relativistic effect that you can imagine in the close vicinity around the black hole, you're going to have it around a neutron star as well. The one thing that you will not have is what happens inside. There's a line here that you can barely see, what I call the photon orbit. Everything inside its own photon orbit is behind the shadow. It's behind the gravitational shadow. This is what we're trying to look for in the black hole in the center of the Milky Way with the Event Horizon Telescope. Neutron stars are outside that. So you will not be able to see things like gravitational shadows, but pretty much everything else a neutron star is going to show to you. And the two-prong aspect of this talk is that one is how can we use neutron star observations to probe some of those strong gravitational field effects, but the other one is how can we use those strong gravitational field effects to find out which of all of those or where in that parameter space is the true equation of state of neutron star. If we know the mass of a neutron star, how can we tell what its radius is? And for the latter, there has been a lot of progress recently, and I really don't understand why a lot of those don't show, but hopefully they will show eventually. So these are actually mass radius measurements from Ferial and her group, from some recent paper and some review article, radius in kilometers, masses in solar masses. You can barely see some of those equations of state, and these are the best current measurement of masses and radii that for individual sources are not as good, give or take a couple of kilometers. But the fact that you have all of them lining up there, as opposed to close to 15 kilometers, and there's about 12 of them altogether, if you add all of them statistically, then the optimal mass radius constraint from astrophysical objects turns out to be what is shown here in the light blue region compared to all the equations of state. And this is what we have today, the best of what we have today. And of course, you can use that to say something about the underlying equation of state. Pressure as a function of density for neutron star matter. This is the wide variety of equations of state predicted by extrapolating what we can measure down here at low densities towards higher densities. And that cyan region here is what would be the inferred equation of state from the mass and radius measurements astrophysically. Now, two things to point out from this one, which will help a little bit about what we'll do later on. One is that the data today, you can also see it here, want relatively small radii as opposed to large radii, which means that at low densities, the equation of state needs to be relatively soft to allow for the neutron star to be compactified by its own gravity. But at high densities, the equation of state needs to become quite steep, quite harder, in order to allow for two solar mass neutron stars, which we now know they exist. And this transition from soft to steep is actually something that is very, very important for nuclear physics models and plays very, very strong constraints. So it would be great if we have another way other than those spectroscopic measurements to justify or to verify this particular result in a way that is independent of the uncertainties of the spectroscopic measurements, which I'm not going to talk at all about today. So the purpose of the NICER experiment and another mission that's coming up as well, and the purpose and the main goal of this talk is to talk about a different way of measuring masses and radii of neutron star by exploiting their gravitational effects in a way that does not suffer perhaps from the same uncertainties as the spectroscopic method, an independent way of doing it. And that goes back to the idea that because of its strong gravitational lensing, the amount of pulsation that you're going to see when you have a particular emitting region onto the neutron star spinning around it will depend on how compact the neutron star is. And I will explain that in a second. Why does that happen? Well, let's take a neutron star and let's shoot photons, lights from the left, and shoot them backwards towards the neutron star to see where they're coming from. Because of gravitational lensing, the photon rays, the null geodesics, are going to bend. Some of them actually are going to go behind. And effectively, what you will see is that if it was a purely Newtonian star without any gravitational lensing, you would only be able to see 90 degrees away from the radial direction down. But because of gravitational lensing, you have some of those photon rays that come more than 90 degrees behind the neutron star. So effectively, because of lensing, you get the backside of the neutron star unfolding and becomes observable to an observer at infinity. How far back does this show? This is actually very barely behind. This is something that you can calculate in the weak, in the slow spin analytically. So this is the compactness of the neutron star. Put G's and C's, so it doesn't matter. Radius divided by mass. And this is the maximum angular distance behind the neutron star where you can see things at infinity. If it was purely Newtonian, it would have been 90 degrees. As it becomes more and more compact, it goes all the way practically to 180 degrees behind. This is the range of radius to mass ratios predicted by different equations of state, and what that tells you between 120 and 160 degrees. So for most of the equations of state, the self-gravitational lensing is so significant that you can practically see between 120 and 160 degrees behind the star. Most of the neutron star unfolded to any observer at infinity. And just to give you a little visual of how that works, this is a neutron star. We put a grid on top of the neutron star longitude and latitude. This is purely Newtonian. So one pole will be down here, the other pole will be down there, and you see only plus or minus 90 degrees. And I'm just going to keep the radius of the neutron star constant, and I'm going to crank up its mass, increase gravity. What will happen is that the neutron star will appear to be bigger and bigger because now you start looking from behind. At some point, you start looking at both poles. It becomes also redder. You see one pole here, the other pole is there. And at the largest possible mass that we allowed here, you practically see all the neutron star behind and the entire thing amplified because of its own gravitational self-lensing. What that means is that if I have a hot spot, like something that emits hotter on the neutron star than the rest of the surface, as it rotates around, If it was purely Newtonian, I will see some particular amplitude of pulsation, but because I can see from behind, it means that the amplitude of pulsation is going to be suppressed, because I never lose sight of it. Right. And this is something that was actually calculated numerically back in 1983 by Pecenik, Flaktas, and Quinn, and I think it was Pecenik's PhD thesis, where what they did is they put just, this is pure, you know, geometric, just a little hotspot on the surface of a neutron star. This is the pulse phase. It's actually two of them, so that's why you only see half of the pulse phase. A given convectness of the neutron star, this is the opposite of what I was showing before, so it's like four before, gives you a nice big pulse profile. And as you increase the convectness of the neutron star, you see it more and more further behind, and the pulse amplitude drops. There's a point where it crosses a caustic and you see a little blip in the back, but don't worry about that. This is not something that we care about. So the idea is, what if we find sources that we can tell emit thermally from their surfaces, but not from the entire surface, from a small patch on their surface? Then we measure the pulse profiles and their amplitudes and use those observations to constrain the masses and radii of the neutron star based on the amplitudes that we observe. And of course, this is easier said than done, because first of all, you need to find sources, to identify sources that have those properties, that you can tell for a fact that what you're seeing is surface emission, and not surface emission from the entire neutron star, but from a patch on it. And then you have to build an instrument, which is not what we are doing, that actually goes there and does that measurement to the accuracy that you need it. And 20 years ago, this is where we were. What are the good sources? We knew how to do the basic calculation. What are the good sources? And what would be a good instrument to do it? Instead of going historically now and identify, tell you what the sources are first, and then tell you what the instruments are, I'm going to do it backwards. I'm going to tell you what are the instruments that are coming up this year and in the future, and what are the primary targets that they're going to observe, what are their pros and what are their cons. And the one that is the most imminent and the most exciting is NICER, the Neutron Star Interior Composition Explorer. It used to be called NICE the first time that they proposed it. It didn't go through, so they made it NICER. And you know, NASA liked it, so it is being built. And the true story. And this is actually a explorer-level mission that is not an actual satellite. What you do is you build the X-ray detector. And with a SpaceX mission that's going to launch, I believe, May 14th this year, is going to be put on one of the pads on the International Space Station. So it's actually much cheaper than building an entire satellite, because it uses a lot of the infrastructure and the launch vehicle that goes to the space station. If you plot its effective area as a function of energy, you see that it's primarily a soft X-ray detector, just like XMM Newton, but a factor of a few more efficient than XMM Newton. And the other good thing that it has is that it has a very accurate time tagging of the photons and a very stable clock that not only does it have a 300 nanosecond timing resolution, but you can actually time tag photons over the lifetime of the duration of the instrument over several years, so you can fold them based on the known period of the pulsars, which will turn out to be very important. The prime targets for NICER are rotation-powered pulsars. And they can be in binaries, or they can be in their surface. They can be isolated. And the idea here is the reason that we have in the X-ray thermal emission from those pulsars is because of the presence of the pairs that generate the radio and the gamma ray emission in the magnetosphere. Those pairs eventually turn back towards the polar cap. They bombard the polar cap, they deposit that energy deep inside, and that energy eventually comes out as thermal emission from a very, very small patch around the polar cap. This is the underlying idea. These are extremely faint sources, and the only reason that you can do that work with something like NICER, which is a relatively small instrument, just a little higher than XMM, is because they're extremely stable clocks. The ephemeris for the known targets has been well measured in the radio. So you can observe that those targets for many, many months and fold the photons that you measure to the precise, ephemeris, the precise period of that pulsar, and then you can combine a pulse profile with upwards of a million photons per target. And a million photons turns out to be the magic number to be able to do the kind of calculations that we want to do. The other good thing is, besides the stable frequencies, that several of them are members of binary systems not accreting, so non-interacting binary systems with white dwarfs, and you can use relativistic effects from radio timing, like Shapiro delays and periaston precession, to measure very precisely the mass of the star. So you don't only, you don't have to measure independently the mass and the radius using those relativistic effects. You know one of those properties a priori. As I said, how do we think, why do we think this emission, thermal emission, comes from? Well, it's the return currents from the magnetospheric pairs that generate the other emission. And recently, because of Fermi, there has been a lot of work trying to predict the size, the shape, and the temperature distribution of those polar cap patches, either in force-free magnetosphere or in peak simulations. And just to give you an idea, this is a particular example by Zhuining and Anatoly Spitkovsky, where it's looking down the polar cap of one of those millisecond pulsars, spinning millisecond pulsars. What changes here is the relative orientation between the rotation pole and the magnetic pole, because that affects a little bit, because of relativistic effects, the structure of the field. And what you have here is you see a range of the flux of particles that is being deposited very close to the pole. For the purposes of this particular image, they used an extremely rapidly spinning pulsar. It's a sub-millisecond pulsar, such that the light cylinder is at four times the neutron star surface, which is why the polar cap is so big. As I will say later, the pulsars that NICER is targeting are going to have very, very, very small polar caps, of the order of 10 to 15 degrees, which turns out to be an important ingredient in the argument. Now, if you take one of those polar cap structures and put it onto a neutron star, two opposing poles, this is something done by Michi, then you get those kinds of pulse profiles, thermal pulse profiles with particular temperature and pulse amplitude characteristics. And then you go and observe them. And this is the best that we have so far. There is work by Slavko Pogdanov, who was a graduate student here with Joseph a few years back and started all of that. This is the prototype source for NICER, a particular pulsar J0437 plus minus 4715. This is how it looks in the radio. This is how it looks in the X-rays. And this is how it looks in the gamma rays. The radio and the X-rays are all aligned because it's meant to be related to the footprints of the magnetic pole, of the magnetic fields around the polar cap. The gamma rays are misaligned, and I will say something about that later, as expected. But this is the thermal X-ray emission that we expect to see from the return currents that give rise to that radio emission, and this is what XMM has observed. Now, I told you about all the wonderful things about all those systems, stable sources, thermal emissions, small hotspots, small patches, good ephemeris, a nice instrument to see it. There are, of course, problems as well. One of them is that the spectra are actually very difficult to calculate from first principles. People start fitting them with things like multiple black bodies and hydrogen atmospheres in the polar caps and this and that. They're quite broad. So they're not single temperature spectra, single temperature thermal spectra. And you could have expected it when I showed you the flux of current density that is imparted onto the polar caps. That was not uniform. So different parts of the polar cap are going to have different temperatures, and they're going to give rise to broad spectra. But there's also some what appears to be a contamination from the magnetosphere. There's a power law component that actually extends all the way up to hard X-rays. And last year, observations with NuSTAR showed, as expected, that that component is also pulsing. Because if it is from the magnetosphere, it's going to rotate together with the rest of the magnetosphere and the neutron star. And that messes up a little bit what we will do. However, in the soft X-rays, it's about a factor of 30 to 100 below the thermal emission. So it is not a major, major component in what we do. Good things and bad things. Now, this is not the only kind of sources where we can do this. You can also try and look for the thermal emission during the early stages of an X-ray burst on a neutron star, of a thermonuclear flash on a neutron star. If I gave this talk 10 years ago, I would call it AXSTAR, the mission. If I gave this talk 5 years ago, I would call it LOFT. As of 3 days ago, I will call it STROBE-X, because this is one of the probe class missions that was selected last week by NASA for a concept study. It was funded for a concept study. And what it is, it has two main types of detectors. One is a super NICER, so this is the effective area of straw bags compared to NICER. And the other is a super XT. This is straw bag SLAD, and this is XT. Each one of them is a factor of 10 to 50 larger than the previous mission. And the idea is that this is meant to be effectively the next generation super XT slash super NICER, where you can do very high timing resolution studies of bright sources. This is not an imaging instrument, of bright sources with, you know, more than a factor of 100 photons than what you can do with XT or what you can do with NICER. Clearly, when it flies, if it flies, it will do things better than what NICER does, but the important difference that NICER cannot do is it can look in harder X-rays, several kV, and then you can look at the thermal emission from thermonuclear flasses. Thermonuclear flasses is what happens when you have an accreting neutron star and matter, the accreting matter gets compressed, becomes unstable due to helium triple alpha, and it ignites at some point. In the beginning of this movie, this is a movie by Anatoly Spitkovsky about 15 years ago. It ignites at some point, and it takes several, you know, a good fraction of a second before it actually covers, engulfs the entire neutron star because of a number of effects. And if you cut that burst in its initial phases, the first, say, quarter second, the first half second, then you have an extremely bright, very thermal, it's from very deep in the surface of the star, very localized emission on the surface of the neutron star. So what you expect to see is you expect to see for a couple of seconds that pulsation to go, and as the bursting front spreads and the size of the hotspot covers the entire neutron star, you expect that amplitude to go down. And of course, this is something that has been observed by XT. This was one of the main discoveries of the Ross X-ray Timing Explorer 20 years ago. This is what the XT data look like if you take one of those oscillations and you fold them into the period. You know, you can barely see that there is a period, let alone make accurate measurements from that. That's why you want to go to 10 times bigger than XT to take all those error bars and shrink them. The good thing with those sources is that they're extremely bright. These are some of the brightest sources in the X-ray universe when they burst. And the emission is very well understood. This is something that comes deep down from a completely ionized atmosphere. It doesn't get easier to calculate the radiation transfer properties to this plasma. However, their frequencies are known to drift a little bit later on in the burst, so you can only use the very beginning. And because of that and the fact that they engulf the neutron star rather quickly, you can only use them for a fraction of a second. So contrary to the case of the pulsars, you cannot observe for a year and then fold them together. You have a hand, like 250, whatever, quarter second, half a second to observe, and that's all the time that you have, which means that you want a really, really big, you know, photon bucket to be able to collect a million photons in a quarter second, which is what Strobex is aiming to do.
How strongly the effective radius should change with time?
With time. Why would it change with time?
Well, if it's thermal, it's going to be thicker. You don't see the...
You don't mean radius, you mean the
radius,
yeah. Sure, the height of the atmosphere, if you wish. Yeah. So the compared to the size of the neutron star, the atmosphere, unless you have some major event, is not going to rise too much. So unless you have something that is near Eddington, it's going to rise by a few centimeters, and that's very small compared to 10 kilometers. So the effect is actually quite minor. People try to use it for the small drift of the frequency. It doesn't really work. But when you have those radius expansion bursts, when they actually the photosphere expands to several times the neutron star radius, then you lose those oscillations, so you don't see them. By that time, the whole thing is in flames, and you don't have localized emission. So this is very early on. Okay, so we have identified two types of sources, pulsars and bursters. We have a mission that is waiting in Cape Kennedy on top of SpaceX to launch in a month, and one that maybe is going to launch in a couple of years. Is this all we need to do the measurement? And the answer is no, because there's a lot of things that can actually, that are degenerate with the measurements that we want to do, the mass and radius measurements. And we need to find a ways to either avoid the degeneracy or use different effects in order to break the degeneracy. And this is where relativity becomes important. The first obvious thing is, of course, that the geometry of the system, right? You have a hotspot, and it has some collatitude with respect to where the rotation pole is, and you have an observer which observes at some particular inclination. I can make the pulse profile become less strong by making the neutron star more compact, or I can flip the neutron star towards me looking down the pole, and that will suppress the pulse profile. So geometry, like pure geometry, and gravity is geometry, right, are actually very degenerate. And that is something that was realized. I don't know why this died. There we are. Something that was realized back in 97 by George Pavlov and Zavlin, where they tried actually this analysis with very, very early data. I forget even which satellite they used for that. Maybe it's even Chandra, I don't know. Where this is the same, the poster child source 0437 for NICER. And what they noticed is that if you fix the compactness and plot contours of constant amplitude of pulsations as a function of those two orientation angles, what you see is that you see perfect degeneracies. Right? If you say 24% amplitude of pulsations, it can be anywhere here, or 36 can be anywhere here in a little circle there. And this is for a particular compactness. Or you can play the same game by fixing the orientation, and then you have a perfect degeneracy for different compactnesses. So the only way to go beyond that and actually measure masses and radii is to have independent information one way or the other, or parallel information about the inclination. The second important thing that was kind of unexpected was the fact that the spin frequency of those neutron stars between, as I will show, 200 and 600 hertz turns out to be significant and to affect their space-time to the level that we want to know before we can actually do that measurement. And to tell you what kind of frequencies they have, this is a cumulative distribution of frequencies for different types of sources. The blue are the rotation power millisecond pulsars, which are the NICER targets, and the red are the X-ray bursters, which are the targets for strobes. And the median value is about 300 hertz for the pulsars and about 600 hertz for the bursters. And of course, both of them go all the way up to about 700 hertz, which is the fastest known spin frequency of a pulsar. Now, what happens when you spin the neutron star is it depends on how fast you spin it. If you spin it a little, up to a few hundred hertz, then the two main effects are Doppler shifts and time delays. And here is the, maybe I should go from this side. Here is a light curve from this particular orientation, a hotspot moving around just for the sake of the argument. The black one is what you would get, the pulse profile that you would get if it is not, if it's spinning at, say, 1 hertz or below. And the red one and the blue one is the effects of Doppler and time delays for about 600 hertz spin frequency. What it does, what do these effects do, is that they change the pulse profile, they change its harmonic structure of the pulse profile. They're not very sinusoidal anymore. And they shift its peak towards earlier phases. Why does that happen? Well, as you can see here, the color is meant to show the effect of Doppler effect. So things are blue boosted, blue shifted when the spot is moving towards you, and red shifted when the spot is moving away from you. The blue shift and red shift affects not only the energy of the photons, but also affects the brightness of a particular spot. You will get the local flux is brighter here where it's blue shifted, and fainter here where it's red shifted, but the projected area is small here, peaks there, and small there, and the combination of the two makes the pulse profile shift towards an earlier phase. The other issue, the time delays issue, is the fact that the time it takes for photons to cross becomes comparable to cross the neutron star, becomes comparable to the spin period, and therefore, as the hotspot moves from the back of the line of sight towards you, the photons there catch up with the hotspot, and therefore, what you get is that the pulse profile becomes squeezed. It has a much rapider, more rapid increase and a lower decay, and that changes a little bit the harmonic conduct of the pulse profile. This is something that was shown by Brahe, Romani, and Rauch back in 2000. This was the time of 1856, and you might remember there was a big Chandra discretionary director's time to perhaps look for pulsations around 1856. It was not found at the time. But what became relatively clearly after that work is that these are not the only effects that you need to worry about. Because you cannot start asking yourself, as I crank up the spin of the neutron star, what happens to its space-time? What happens to the neutron star itself? When you're below about 100 hertz, the star is practically non-spinning. the star is spherical, its external spacetime is Schwarzschild, and the only thing that you need to know is gm over rc squared. Right? That's the only parameter that determines everything. If you start cranking up the spin, the star remains spherical, the external spacetime becomes scarce, but now frame dragging effects become important. So you need to care about the mass, the radius independently, and the moment of inertia of the neutron star, because that's what determines frame dragging effects. If you go above 500 hertz to about 800 hertz, now the star becomes oblate because it starts spinning really fast. And the external spacetime is not Kerr anymore, because Kerr is a lower order expansion that is true only for black holes. A rotating neutron star spacetime is not a Kerr spacetime, it's just an approximation. But then you need to worry about the mass, the radius, the moment of inertia, the quadruple moment of the neutron star, and the oblateness, polar to equatorial radius. And if you go to even faster spins, then there's no analytic spacetime that you can use. You actually have to calculate the spacetime from scratch based on using numerical relativity calculations. And it turns out, given the rates of spin frequency that we're talking about, 3 to 600 hertz, that we are mostly in this regime. We're in the oblate, quadruple, Hartle-Thorn external spacetime of the neutron star. And to give you some idea of what happens when you start having those additional effects, first of all, let's do the symbol projection of a grid on the neutron star. When I start spinning it up, this is omega now, so 2 pi times the frequency. Two different equations of state. This is a very soft equation of state, so not much really happens. This is a stiff equation of state. And when you start spinning the neutron star becomes oblate and asymmetric because of frame dragging and the gravitational quadruple. And what is even more interesting, and that was completely unexpected, is that those effects can actually become observable even today if only we had seen a line out of a spinning neutron star, an atomic line. And this is why. What we did here is we took a neutron star, we spun it up to 600 hertz, which is normal frequency. We put an atomic line on the neutron star, an emission line, it doesn't matter what it is. And we calculated what would that line appear if it was a delta function on the neutron star, if observed at infinity. And because the neutron star is spinning, it's going to be Doppler broadened, right? Part of the neutron star is spinning towards you. In this case, it's spinning this way, so the line comes out purple. Part of the neutron star is spinning away from you, the line comes out red. And when you calculate the total flux, you get a nicely broadened line, which is why we think we don't really see any lines from those neutron stars. They've been broadened, rotationally broadened. But look what happens when I change the inclination with which I see the neutron star. This is at 90 degrees. This is one pole. This is the other. And this is the rotational broadening width of the line. As the neutron star becomes closer and closer to the pole, first of all, you expect the 1 over sine inclination reduction of the rotational broadening. But much less than that, the line generates an extremely narrow core, which, of course, if you were to put it in on top of a continuum spectrum, the narrow core is the only thing that you would ever see. So somehow, relativity effects take a broad rotational, like a rotationally broadened line, and generate an extremely narrow core, which will be the dominant observable. Why does that happen? Well, let's compare. These are contours, the lines that you will see with different colors, of constant redshift out of the surface of the neutron star. This is what you would expect to see if you just had the Schwarzschild metric, the Doppler effects, and the oblateness of the neutron star. And you see what you would expect, practically vertical lines, redshifted here, blue shifted there. But if I add that little quadruple, which is a few percent effect, then what you get is you get a little island of a particular redshift. Because that quadruple changes slightly that steep dependence of the redshift out of the neutron star. What does that island mean? It means that I'm going to have a big chunk of the surface of the neutron star that comes on a given redshift, and this is what gives rise to that narrow core. So if you go back to that movie, you will see that as the core shows up, that little island appears here. And this island is really the result of cancellation of relativistic effects and Doppler effects, and the only thing that shows up is the quadruple mass moment of the neutron star, which is a second-order relativistic effect that we were not expecting to see. Punchline of that is that if you do see a narrow line out of a known fast-rotating neutron star, does not mean that this line does not come from the neutron star. right? Don't, and we have done it before ourselves, don't use the width of a line out of a rapidly rotating neutron star to argue that this line is not surface because it has been rotational broadened. If you can identify that line and say for sure that it does come from the neutron star, then you will be able to measure the quadruple moment of the neutron star, and that is a very, very important measurement. So perhaps the next generation satellite with a very high energy resolution, and I'm going to say, not going to say names here, there are people that, you know, are very involved in a lot of them. If they can make such a measurement from a rotating neutron star, that will be a very, very important result.
But if you have such a narrow line, as far as I can tell, it's mostly when the pole is toward you.
Inside 40.
It's not a good pulsar, probably.
So the line becomes narrow inside about 40 degrees from the pole. And if you care about pulsations, then you're right. Those particular systems are not going to have very strong pulsations. But we can see lines from things like from bursters that are not, you know, don't have strong pulsations. Yeah, this is a completely unrelated to what I've been talking about. Talking about pulsations, what happens is that the exact same second order effects, the effects of the oblateness, the effect of the quadrupole, if you compare them, so red is the Hartle-Thorne metric that has all those effects, and the green line is the one where you don't take them into account, give rise to about 10% differences that you need to take into account if you care to measure the masses and the radii to within 10%, right? The effects of the higher order variations are comparable to the accuracy with which you want to know. And what that means is we want to use, say, with NICER, observe a light curve, and this is a theorist light curve without any error bars. And if you have a million photons, it will look very close to that, right? A million photons over many time beams. But you need to be able to use that light curve to infer 8 parameters. We started by saying mass and radius, but you know, it is the mass and the radius. But then it depends on the oblateness of the star, the moment of inertia, and the quadruple moment of its spacetime, the size of the spot, because if the spot is very big, then the path profile goes down, where the spot is on the star, and the inclination of the observer. And that is too much, way too many parameters, right? We cannot expect, and you will see why, that by just doing a single observation of a single light curve, as good as you want to have it, you're going to be able to infer all of those 8 parameters to the accuracy that you want. But it turns out that some of those parameters you don't really have to measure because they're the ones about the space-time properties of the neutron star, because they're very, very highly correlated between them. This is magic. We don't understand why. After this work, it became a very, very big industry in gravitational wave physics under the name of universal relations in neutron stars. It turns out that if you know the compactness of a neutron star and its spin frequency, then you can predict things like its ellipticity for all equations of state. To within a percent or 2%, they all follow the same line. You can predict its spin angular momentum, and that gives you the moment of inertia, and if you know the moment of inertia, you can predict its quadruple moment to within a couple of percent. The equation of state for a given mass and radius tells you where you are along that line. But if you know the mass and the radius and the spin, then because of this magic universal properties of neutron stars, then you have all the other properties of its spacetime.
So I don't understand. You showed that for the soft equation of state and hard equation of state, you have quadrupole completely different.
Correct.
You're saying it's the same.
It is not the same. The quadrupole depends on the moment of inertia, and the moment of inertia depends on the compactness. This is gm over rc squared. So a soft equation of state will give you a bigger compactness, so m over r, or a smaller compactness, a bigger r over m. And that will give you a different spin, a different moment of inertia, and a different quadrupole. But if you take the proper ratios, it doesn't matter. So there is a single. So knowing the compactness, mass and radius and spin, you know all the properties of the neutron star spacetime. You can also do it with another parameter that people in gravitational waves care about, the deformability of the neutron star. When you have two neutron stars next to each other, they're tidally deformed. And that number goes by the name of Love, the Love number. So that you might hear of all this field either as a universal relations or the I love Q relations. Ken Yagi and Nico Yunis did that based on, you know, the work that we had started for the NICER thing. And it turns out that these relations depend on the validity of general relativity. So if you can measure these relations independently from gravitational waves, then you can say something about general relativity as opposed to about neutron stars, which is a wonderful side effect of this work. So we don't have to worry about all these higher order moments of the neutron stars. We have relations, we get rid of them. How about the spot size? And by spot size, I'm going to do a Sean Spicer to you and call it the spot size, air quotes, to imply anything that involves the structure of the spot. Right? It can be the temperature profile, it can be anything that happens on the spot. Because as I showed you, the pulse profiles are not, polar caps are not uniform in temperature. So you're wondering, how the heck would you know what a correct temperature profile is? Well, it turns out it doesn't really matter as long as the spot is small. What we're trying to do here is effectively do astrometry, or geodesy if you want, on the star, based on things, on timing, based on things that we observe at a distance. And when you do astrometry in the sky, if you do not resolve the object that you're doing astrometry with, it doesn't matter what its structure is, right? If you get a quasar far away in radio and it's a dot, it doesn't matter that inside that dot there's a jet, there's an accretion disk, there's this and that. The only thing that matters is that it's a dot. And a gravitational lens, the self-lensing of a neutron star, is effectively the same. It lenses whatever the structure is to something bigger. And as long as that structure is smaller than your effective resolving power, you don't care. So this is four different situations, and this is just for illustration reasons. This is a small spot, 5 degrees, 15 degrees, 10 degrees, and 40 degrees. And these are the pulse profiles that they generate. And the three of them, the first three, 5, 10, and 15, are one on top of the other. And the 40-degree profile is away. So, and this is something that we can quantify given different spot characteristics and quantifying in terms of the harmonic contents of the pulse profiles. Effectively, as long as your spot size is less than about 15 to 20 degrees, it doesn't matter. Its structure, its temperature profile, its size, its outline, doesn't matter because you cannot resolve it with the timing effects that you're measuring. And this is good because, first of all, it takes away one of the biggest uncertainties in the problem. It would have been impossible to believe and correct for, you know, particular properties of the spot. But the reason that it does is that for a pulsar, the size of the polar cap depends only on its spin frequency. This is a histogram of pulsars based on the spin frequency, and this is effectively a histogram of pulsars based on the sizes of their spots. Most of them are between 10 and 18 degrees. So for most NICE sources, especially for the one that is the poster child, which is about 270 hertz, the size of the spot is so small that we can just throw it away, put a dot on our neutron star, do our calculations, and forget about it.
Interesting. Just the spot size or how close it gets to the pole?
That is different. This is just the spot size. Now, the orientation is something that makes a very big effect. And that's something that you need to know about. So that brings me to the next point. Okay, we got rid of all the higher order moments of the neutron star. We got rid of the spot size. We're left with four parameters: mass, radius, location of the spot, and orientation of the observer. Clearly, if I have a million photons, I can split my pulse profile into, say, 128 beams. I have 128 observables, four parameters, a lot of degrees of freedom to do a very beautiful measurement. The answer is no, because even though you can get as many time beams as you want with a million photons, the pulse profiles don't have that much information. And the way to see it is take a pulse profile, a real pulse profile from one of those complex calculations, say at 1 hertz, slowly spinning neutron star, and plot on top of it a sign. Right? Gravitational lensing wipes out all the higher order harmonics. The fact that you can see behind the star means that what you're left with are small. I mean, the fact that the pulsation drops means what you're left is with small, nearly sinusoidal pulse profiles. And if you do a power spectrum, this is harmonic number, you see a beautiful fundamental and noise and everything else, and this is assuming a million photons in the pulse. So even with a million photons, you cannot see anything. What if I spin it up? Remember, Doppler effects start distorting the pulse profile? Let's make it at 600 hertz. Fundamental, harmonic, and nothing else. So if you're looking at nicer sources, there's really only one number that you can measure from the entire light curve. You're going to measure it extremely well because you have a million photons. It's the ratio between this and the noise. but only one number, and you can use it whichever way you want to measure for. And if you have a rapidly spinning neutron star and you see the entire light curve, you can measure two numbers and that's it. But you have four unknowns. This is where additional information becomes important. For nicer sources, for nicer targets, the poster childs are members of binary systems with white dwarfs, non-interacting binaries, and we can use relativistic effects to measure their masses. This is the most recent work by Riordan and Toll in 2015, where there was some issue with the timing noise of J0437. They did a very careful analysis of the timing noise, and you can see this is different realizations of their errors for the different parameters, eccentricity, orbital period derivatives, omega dot, various other things. And this is what they expected to be. So now they understand their errors extremely, extremely well, and they can pinpoint the mass to 1.44 plus or minus 0.07 solar masses. This is a 5% measurement uncertainty in the mass, and this is exactly the level that you want for both the mass and the radius. So one goes away, we still have radius and two inclinations. Well, the other two inclination parameters will come from what I said earlier about looking at the relative orientation between the relative phase between radio, X-ray, and gamma ray pulses. Because this is some work that started a long, long time ago. This is one of the very earlier papers by Roman and Yediaroglu in 95, and can be done much better these days with false free calculations and peak simulations, where you can plot as a function of viewing angle and the phase of the pulsar. So this is the sky map unfolded for you, where you expect the radio and the X-ray emission to happen. So this is the polar caps, and where you expect the gamma ray emission to happen. And then you have X-rays, radio emission, and the gamma rays that are offset. And you ask yourself, at what viewing angle, where can I cross this map in order to get the relative orientation, relative widths, and relative sizes of the radio, gamma ray, and X-ray pulse profiles? Now, for the case of the X-rays, that does not depend that much on the model, because everything is that little spot, as we said, in the middle of the neutron star. For the case of the gamma rays, that does depend on the model. And we have, of course, Fermi, that we have beautiful data for that. And when people try to do it, this is by Pierre Battista et al., Alice Harding at Goddard and some other people, they do it for a very, very large number of pulsars, and they do it for different models, outer gap models, polar cap models, and this and that. And what you see is that each one of those models has extremely well-measured angles. So this is one angle and this is the other, so 87 plus or minus 2 degrees. However, there is a dichotomy between the polar cap models, where the emission is coming very close, the acceleration very close to the cap, and the outer gap models. So effectively what you do is you have two islands of solutions. 6, 7, 8 degrees plus or minus 5, 70, 80 degrees plus or minus 5. And you can use one or the other, and you're going to get, of course, two completely different values of the masses and the radii. The good news is that those very, very low angles, very small angles, would never give rise to the pulse amplitudes that we observe, so you can actually completely reject them based on the X-ray pulse amplitude. So what that means is that using that information, ICER will give us, for some cases, two blobs on mass and radius, and for some of them, one of them will be completely rejected by the X-ray, and you will have a single blob based on that information. A couple more minutes just to say one last thing. I don't want to spend any time on that because this is something for the future. You might ask yourself, okay, what you said is based on the particulars of the nicer sources, we know the masses, we know the inclinations. What if we look at those bursts that we know neither? Well, the good news is that those bursts are very, very rapidly spinning, 500-600 hertz. And then we can actually play a little game with the energy dependence of the pulse profiles. So if I were to plot as before the flux, as a function of phase for one of those situations will be like that. But if I define an X-ray color, like the way that we do in X-ray, say 2 to 20 divided by 1 to 2 kV, and plot the X-ray color as a function of pulse phase, what you will see is that I get something that is displaced, which is exactly what you expect, because clearly the spectrum is bluer here and the spectrum is redder there, but most of the flux comes when the hotspot is in the middle and almost no flux comes when the hotspot is behind. So there is a phase difference between different energy bands that I plotted here as a color with respect to the flux. And as I said, when you go to 400, 500, 600 hertz, you can actually measure two parameters from the pulse profile, which is the fundamental, and it's harmonic because of the Doppler shifts. So if you like parameter counting, we can measure the amplitude of the flux oscillations, and it's harmonic. We can measure the amplitudes of the color oscillations. You won't be able to do anything with its harmonic, it's too low. And you can measure the phase shift between the color oscillation and the flux oscillation. Four parameters, four unknowns, mass, radius, and two orientation angles. And you hope at this point that the four parameters that you measure are not degenerate. And when you do that calculation, and this is some work we've done a couple of years ago, this is how they break the degeneracy. The blue line is the line of degeneracy because of the flux amplitude. The green line is the line of degeneracy because of its harmonic. The red line is the line of degeneracy because of the color. It's mostly measuring Doppler effect, that's why it's vertical. And this is the line of degeneracy because of the phase difference. And you can do the same thing for the two orientation angles. It's a four-dimensional parameter space. And what you see is that by measuring effectively those two four independent properties of the pulse profiles in two energy bands, you completely break the degeneracy and you pinpoint the mass and the radius and the inclinations angles of the neutron star. You can do that for a burster because it's rapidly spinning. We might be able to do it for one of the nicer sources if we can find a nearby fast spinning neutron star to be able to do the thermal X-ray emission. We don't know of any of them yet with NICER. We only know the slow spinning ones, but then we can do something else. But this is the way that we can break the degeneracy between the two. So just to put everything together, there are two missions, one that is actually built and waiting on top of a rocket as we speak, to be launched hopefully in May, called NICER, and one that is in the works called STROBE-X, to go and take this very generic idea of 20 years ago of using relativity to measure masses and radii of neutron stars in a way that is completely independent with any other way that we have not done so far. I didn't say much, but you can easily see that this is a measurement that is distance independent because you only do fractional amplitudes, calibration independent because you do only fractional amplitudes. So all of the issues of spectroscopic measurements of radii are not relevant to this particular method. When it comes to NICER, we have to find a way to break the degeneracy, and that way comes from independent knowledge of fundamental parameters. When it comes to the bursters, that additional knowledge comes from higher order relativistic effects that affect the spectral evolution of the pulse profiles. I think as far as theorists are concerned, we're done with knowing what needs to be done. So now we put our statisticians' hats and try to plug all of those and try to beat the statistics of the measurements to see what will happen with masses and radii. NICER will get, if everything goes well, the complete first data set for the prototype star in 6 months after launch. That makes it Christmas of next year. So we might be able to have a result within a year from now, give or take. And that's all. Thank you very much. Disagreement.
So, Demetrius, that very beautiful mass result for 0437 is somewhat surprising because it's been spun up, obviously, during its element's B phase, and we know of two solar mass
I think Ferel can have a lot more to say about that. It's hard to tell what the history of each individual source is, and you might want to look into the distribution of masses and ask yourself what is the distribution of accretion histories. It doesn't take much mass for anything to be spun up, right? You can do it with a tenth of a thousandth of a solar mass with around a neutron star that has, a few times 10 to the 9 Gauss magnetic field because the lever arm is very big and you can spin it up to milliseconds with no mass attached to it. When you look at the mass distribution of those pulsars, you find a broad distribution around 1.5 solar masses and then a bump that goes all the way up to 2 solar masses. And there's ways to think that maybe it's just a tail of the, the ones that happen to have more masses, or maybe they were born there, but it's not atypical. Like, this is not the only one. Actually, the vast majority of recycled millisecond pulsars that we see are around 1.5 solar masses. Why is that? I will...
And even for the 1.9 solar mass sources, on a case-by-case basis, you can rule out significant accretion for some of them. So there must be birth masses that span the range from 1.3 to 1.8.
Yeah. I would find it extremely difficult to explain honestly the narrowness as opposed to the to the breadth, right? That's the bigger problem.
Another question? Now, let's say the